Good morning, and I would like to welcome everyone to the fifth meeting of the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee in 2021. For members and witnesses who are on blue jeans, please can you remember to put an R in the chat function as your request to speak. The first agenda item today is to consider whether or not the committee will hear a complaint from the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland, and that this should be taken in private at a future meeting. Are the committee agreed with this?
Agreed.
Agreed.
Committee are agreed. Our second item relates to subordinate legislation, and we are going to take evidence on two affirmative SSIs and two negative SSIs. And I would like to welcome George Adam, Minister for Parliamentary Business, and his officials, Ian Hockenhull and Craig McGuffey. I would now like to invite the Minister, if you'd like to make a short opening statement about these, and then the committee will have questions. Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and as always, it's a pleasure to be here. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to discuss the proposed changes to the procedures for running local government elections in Scotland. The measures laid out in the measures before you today were carefully developed to assist the delivery of next May's local government elections. They apply some of the changes made ahead of this year's Scottish Parliament elections and reflect recent primary legislation by Parliament on the franchise and wider electoral reform. While our focus has been on clarifying and strengthening existing approaches, we've also taken the opportunity to update electoral rules to strengthen our system and improve the experience for candidates and for voters. For example, we're bringing in new exemptions to candidates' spending in relation to costs for security, adaptations for disabilities and translation. This aligns with the approach taken for the Scottish Parliament election this year and reflects the importance of accessibility, inclusion and safety. Development of these instruments have benefited from close engagement with key stakeholders, including the Electoral Management Board, the Electoral Commission and the Scottish Parliament Political Parties Panel. These partners and the wider electoral community continue to play a vital role in shaping policy and ensuring that voters have the best experience on polling day. I want to take this chance to thank them for their support and their reflections and look forward to working closely with them on the preparations for May 2022. In the coming months. I hope you will agree that these provisions are positive changes which will benefit voters, candidates and administrators, and you will therefore give your support to these orders. And I'm willing to take any questions, and I thank you for listening to me.
Thank you for that, Minister. My intention is to work through each of the four SSIs that are in front of us in order so that it will make the next agenda item more straightforward. So if we can look at the first one, the Representation of the People Postal Voting for Local Government Elections Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021. And I'm going to hand over to Paul, I think, who has some questions.
Thank you, Convener. And can I refer everyone to my register of interest? I'm a councillor serving at the moment on East Lothian Council, and I'm glad you read out the act there rather than save myself that. Minister, welcome. Really just talking around about the deadline changing from 5 p.m. to 10 p.m. on polling days, and the question is really, why was the deadline previously 5 p.m. and what impact do you think that would have on electoral administrators?
Okay then, I can answer your first question first. By saying that the fact that the 10 p.m. deadline was actually created so that we would be on a parity with the Scottish elections. So that was first and foremost. With regard to why it was 5 p.m. Initially, I think that may have been lost in the annals of time, but I will possibly ask one of my officials, Ian, if you could possibly help me out in this one.
Lost in the annals of time is pretty much what I was going to say. we could investigate if it would be of interest to the committee. I personally don't know.
Thanks for that, Minister. Again, just looking, you know, was there any indication, I suppose, from previous elections about anybody being disenfranchised when it being 5 p.m. rather than 10?
On the whole, I don't think there was. I'll probably ask you to give you some more detail on that as well. But on the whole, I don't think there was issues. There's always been a flexibility regarding people when they've had to turn up. Yes, there'll always be times where it'll be difficult and people won't do it. And we have to make sure that we deal with that situation as well. But what we've tried to do is create a flexibility so that there is that opportunity for everyone to get not be disenfranchised in any shape or form. But with regard to the detail, I'll ask you to give give you some answers on that.
We don't have any particular data or people saying one way or the other that they'd been disadvantaged, but the experience of the Scottish Parliament election suggested that just offering those 5 extra hours would help the odd case of someone who was disadvantaged, potentially disadvantaged in this way. We've asked stakeholders or electoral administrators to monitor how this goes and see if there are any complaints, but the Electoral Commission were very much in favour of this change as well.
Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. And I think it's certainly fair to say in the previous election there were events in East Lothian that led to an emergency proxy being issued at about 9 o'clock. And I could see the same event occurring with the council election. So thank you for that. Does any other committee member have a question on that SSI before we move to the next one? I'll take silence as we've got through that one. The next one we're going to look at is the Scottish Local Government Elections Amendment Order 2021. And indeed, I'm going to take convener's privilege on this one and jump off because there are a couple of matters that do concern me. The first is in relation to the equality impact assessment. I note from the information that was provided that there was an assurance that this would be published before it was laid before the Chamber, and indeed it has been laid to come with it. But I don't know whether, Minister, you have sight of it, but there were some questions that were raised in the compilation of the Equality Impact Assessment, which requested that follow-up after the election on how expenditure exclusion is used may be helpful in understanding the impact of the policy. And in addition, the Equality Impact Assessment makes reference to a lack of data to really feed into the decision-making. I wonder whether, firstly, the practicalities of whether it will be followed up and we can have that assurance, and secondly, on a sort of slightly higher level, whether you had any concerns regarding the Equality Impact Assessment, given the lack of data about the people it applies to.
At this stage, I'll probably bring Ian to actually answer that in more detail.
Certainly, the intention is to monitor the progress and see how it goes to inform any future elections orders. So the data is not really, the data reference that you referenced is not really for this particular order, it's more just for future developments. We consulted with a number of groups and stakeholders, we wrote out to a number of community groups, and first, I think we only actually had a response from Age Scotland, but overall no particular concerns were raised.
If I just go back to what the Equality Impact Assessment said, in relation to, and we're talking about excluding certain items from the expenditure, it does very specifically say follow-up after the elections on how this expenditure exclusion is used may be helpful in understanding the impact of the policy. So I understand it, and obviously it needs to apply to future elections because you don't have the data on this one. But it seems to me to be a very strong request that without confirmation on that follow-up, the actual effect and impact of this is going to be unknown.
Well, I mean, I suppose we're taking various types of spending in relation to making events accessible to people with disabilities or making publications and saying that those don't count towards the candidate's spending limit. So the idea is really just to see how that goes in terms of what sort of activity does it cover? What do people put in their spending returns where they say this is what we did? And just to see what the pattern and the picture is and see if there's any conclusions from that, whether additions or subtractions should be made.
So it certainly seems to be a challenge for those that drafted the Equality Impact Assessment to say what the impact would be because of the lack of data, and I think that's agreed. Can I push further then and ask, will that follow-up take place on the basis of the expenditure returns that come after the council elections in May next year?
Yes, that's, I think the Electoral Commission look at these matters with their returns, so and returning officers monitor as well, so yes.
I meant in relation to the impact of this policy on the excluded expenditure returns, because this would fall within the government's responsibility
that. We would work with them with their findings, because they would normally do the questioning in the first instance, and then we would look at what the information they discover.
Summarise some of this, convener,
that would be helpful.
We will take the data that we receive from the next election in order to take things forward in the future as well. I think this is we're trying to do something here. I'm aware personally, if I use an example of the expenditure that can be for just for the talking sake of a disabled candidate, because my sister Jennifer is a councillor in Renfrewshire and Paisley, and she, as a disabled candidate, had to have extra support needs, and I think Inclusion Scotland did that for various candidates at the time. So I think when we get that data back, it'll be interesting for us to actually receive that data, so we can actually see what we can do to actually make things more accessible for those that to make sure that everyone can engage and be either a candidate within the process as well. Because granted, I think we all can accept there will be more expenditure for certain candidates.
That's very helpful, and certainly, you know, evidence and discussions that I've had, people with disabilities have felt very much supported in the additional expenditure. It's just really to hone in on a request that was made there and to have that assurance that it will be looked at after March again. And
to be honest, I think it'll be helpful for us all to be able to check that information so that we can tweak it and make sure. We don't claim to have all the answers all the time, and it's a case of making sure that we get things right at one point in the future.
That assurance is very, very helpful. And if I can just turn to a couple more aspects, really for points of clarification. In relation to the additional costs of security, can you explain what was being thought about in that? Because I have asked a number of sitting councillors and prospective councillors, and they didn't really understand what was being referenced by that.
I think it's
except for the assurances.
I think it's just a reference to potential increased security, of course, with the current climate, and the moves might be needed to have security at a venue or a way out of a particular, or maybe not a way out, it's not the right term, but maybe just security at an event that the candidate is speaking at, and to count that, to not count that as part of the spending for that candidate in compiling their returns.
Thank you for that. I mean, obviously, we're living in a period following an absolute tragedy where individual elected members' security and venues where they gather is paramount. But the SSI, in essence, that discussion about security predates the current events. And my understanding is that such additional security is needed in relation to that. There's advice from Police Scotland and indeed other bodies that do that. So I was just really wondering what was being considered at the time, given that the responsibility for funding that security will rest with the individual or their political party that they represent. And the purpose of this SI is merely to allow it to be deducted from the, well, not allowed to, for it to appear in the return, but not to play against the totals that need to be expended. And I was just wondering whether there was, if I could push you, whether there was anything more specific that was considered by that.
I don't think so. I suppose that the general gist of this is really that spending which is not to a candidate's advantage, such as taking account of person's disability or security concerns, that expenditure is not helping them get elected. So it seems reasonable to not have it count for these totals. It's just the general gist.
I convene us to ensure that nobody's disadvantaged in any shape or form, because if they have to have an expense that would be more than an expense that another candidate wouldn't have. So it's just create the parity so that they can be there. I understand where you're trying to come from with regards to security in particular, because we do live in difficult times, and we have to say when the SSI was created, there already had unfortunately been a number of tragedies before this. So that would have been taken into account as we move forward, because I do believe that we have to ensure that all our candidates, whether it be council, parliamentary, for Westminster or Holyrood, are feel safe and have that opportunity to be safe. But at the same time, ourselves as elected officials need to be accessible to the public as well. I heard a security briefing recently where someone explained to me that perhaps you shouldn't advertise your surgeries and shouldn't tell them what time you're turning up. And I went, well, that's not really helpful, because that's what we do. That's what we do. And I think we need to be very careful that we don't end up in that place.
And I have to say, Minister, I think from the actual wording in the statutory instrument itself, which talks about the additional costs that any disabled person would face, is very, very broad. It's only when you start looking into the policy note there appears to be emphases and restrictions put on it. And I absolutely accept, and I wholeheartedly agree, that this should be about removing the additional expenses that some individuals face in running for election as compared to others. And indeed, with the certainty of that answer, it brings me to my last question in relation to this, which was to the bodies that were consulted. I have to say I found it a little limiting, let me put it that way, as to the bodies who were reached out to, given there is substantial evidential experience from various bodies in Scotland that I think would have been able to contribute to this. And I hear what you say about the actual responses that you had, but was there any positive steps made to reach out to any disability organisations and indeed existing elected disabled representatives to feed into this?
I think it was just the organisations listed. I can take the point that we could go further. Can make a note for that for future exercises.
Well, yeah, I'm quite happy to take that on board for the future consultations and how we go forward, because I'm a great believer, as you'll be aware, my wife has multiple sclerosis, so disability and accessibility to everything is quite important to me. Mm-hmm. So I will take that on board and look at various other organisations that we can work with. But on the positive side, the ones we have worked with, we have got good conclusions, and we've actually had outcomes from them as well. So, you know, it's about, yes, can we do things better all the time? You know, every day is a school day. So we'll be able to do things better in the future, and we'll take on board your points. And if there are any groups that you possibly suggest or the members of this committee want to suggest, then quite happy to have a look at that.
I certainly think that would be helpful following the election with the review process that's mm-hmm. been undertaken, just to, if at the very least, capture the experience of how it's worked the first time around, and that would be helpful.
Yeah, personally, that's always a bit that I find, I know it sounds like almost being like a political geek, but I find that quite exciting because you can actually work down how you can make things better. You know, every time something goes wrong, I see it as an opportunity to try and make it better. That sounds as if I'm being a bit cheesy, but it's always the way.
There, absolutely. And I suppose my last question in relation to the SSI, I said it was my last, but this is my last. In relation to how the SSI is going to be applied across Scotland with regard to the deductions and what you're going to do to monitor that across the whole of Scotland, so that we don't have a situation where in one submission certain expenses are allowed to be deducted and on another that hasn't benefited the same way.
Personally, I think on the whole it should be throughout Scotland. I think it's probably our job to ensure that returning officers in every area are aware of that and are aware of that everyone gets equal level of training. I admit where you're coming from, convener, where be as someone who's been part of the electoral process, it can differ from area to area depending on the staffing. I think the difficulty we have at the moment was, if you look at the Scottish elections, was that if you look at some of the things that didn't work out and the issues we've been discussing today, was the fact of how different they were compared to anything else. Now, I can't guarantee what's going to happen between now and May next year with regards to COVID as we move forward. So I can't say that it won't be kind of under these pressures as well. But I think it's down to us to ensure that all the returning officers are aware that these are the key priorities, and they need to make sure that all their staff are aware, and everyone that's working on the election are aware that this is what we want to do.
That's very helpful. Tess, I understand that you have a question, and then I'll come to the rest of the committee.
I do. Thank you, convener. Minister, there's one area that does concern me, and it relates to the order placing an obligation on the returning officer to send an official poll card or notification to a detained prisoner or prisoner held on remand and at the place that they're being detained rather than the address at which they're registered to vote. So could you give us some background why you felt there was a need to change this order, and particularly bearing in mind it affects such a small number of people?
I agree. A lot of the time people will say we make things difficult for ourselves because it is such a small group of individuals. But we're on the principle of everyone needs to have the accessibility to be able to vote and make their vote. One of the things that we've looked at, it can be very difficult. No matter how you look at prisoner voting in any shape or form, it's a difficult position for us to actually find how we can actually make it easier for them to do that, because there's all kinds of complex issues that can happen in between. They could be released early, or they could end up that could be staying longer, incarcerated longer as well. So there's all kinds of variables there that make it quite difficult for us to actually, and it makes it kind of really complex for us. So just to give you the actual detail, I'll ask Ian to give you the reasons why, but just to try and give you the kind of mood music for this, Miss White, is the fact that it's a complex situation that we're trying to make sure it's as simple as possible, but it can be quite challenging.
I think the specific one on the poll card was highlighted by electoral registration officers, who just pointed out that effectively the prisoner would be relying on someone at their home address, then passing on the poll card to them in the prison. So this allows them to go direct to the prisoner.
So it's somebody else, it's rather than a complaint you've received or data that you're making this. So I would just say, what's to stop us leaving this as it is right now? I mean, bearing in mind also our position on prisoner voting, but leaving it where it is, because it is an area of concern, and then reviewing it at some future stage.
You mean the issuing of the poll card to their
Leaving it to the current situation where you're sending it to their home address? Because some people would prefer to have it sent to their home addresses, and that's their main preference, because they get everything sent to their home addresses. So you're actually making an exception for this. So have you actually sought people's input?
It was mainly electoral registration officers suggested it. I mean, I don't think this would be counted as a change that we would expect to be a big difference either way. But
it is a change and it is a concern. So if there's no complaints and nobody's found any difficult, then why make this tweak?
It was suggested it would make it a little easier for most people, and that it wouldn't have to be forwarded on.
So it's not that important to you, it's just a tweak?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm just saying it's an area of concern, and I'd recommend that we leave it where it is right now rather than change anything on it. So if you could consider that, Minister.
We will maybe look on what you've discussed, Miss White, today, but for this SSI that we're going through now, we need to ensure that we have the elections for next year. And I would suggest that if you could bear with us at this stage, and I've given the assurance we will listen and look at what you've suggested, but at the end of the day, we have a process that we were explained by some of our returning officers that this was the way forward, and it was suited better for the electorate themselves. So if we can find other information, other data, we will pursue that at a later date. But for the here and now, to ensure we move forward, I think we have to stick with what we have here in front of us today.
Thank you. Bob, you've had...
Thank you, Convener. A really interesting line of questioning. Of course, there's a general policy agreement across the Parliament. I know some members of the Parliament didn't support prisoner voting, but there's a clear majority in the Parliament, and the policy intent is to maximise the amount of prisoners who have an entitlement to vote, that they exercise that democratic right as part of that journey through their citizenship rights and responsibilities, and there's a broad agreement in the Parliament that that's what we should do. I wonder, Minister, if after the next election you would review what difference it makes sending the polling cards to prisons rather than to home addresses, because the underlying issue is that very, very few prisoners register to vote in the first place, and I suspect very, very few eventually cast their vote. So I suspect this change is about encouraging more people who are in custody to actually exercise their democratic rights. What we want to do is make sure, has this had a positive effect or otherwise? So I'm clearly minded to support this statutory instrument, but I'd be keen to see a degree of review and analysis of the impact this has had after the next election.
Mr. Doris, as always, you make an articulate case for it, and agreed. I think it would be interesting information for us to look at post the election as well. And you are correct, it is all about the rehabilitation and move forward and bringing those that are incarcerated back into society as a whole, and to make sure that we make that as simple and as easy as possible. I do believe that we should maybe look at that detail, and I did make that commitment to Ms. White earlier on, that we will look at that data when it comes in post next year's election.
Thank you. That concludes the evidence in relation to the positive SSIs. We have two more SSIs to deal with, and the next is the representation of the people, variation of limits of candidates, local government election expenses, Scotland, Order 2021. And for this, I'm going to invite Edward, who's with us remotely, to put the questions, Minister. Edward.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. Perhaps you could just help me. I want to try and find out a bit more about the spending limits. The sum of £740 is the one that's been increased. Could you tell me when that was put in place and when it was last reviewed, please?
Sorry, you're quite faint, Mr. Mountain. I never quite heard you there.
OK, I'll move closer to the microphone. Can you hear me now?
Now you're the voice of God.
As I hoped. OK, so maybe that's something to do with broadcasting. Minister, my question was that the £740 limit that was set, which is the one that's been reviewed, when was that set and when was it last reviewed?
I'll ask Ian to answer that one for us, Mr. Mountain.
I am reasonably confident it would be in the previous main local government elections order before the 2017 elections, but I wouldn't swear to that. I can double check, but essentially these figures get reviewed ahead of every major election cycle and updated largely to take account of inflation.
But we'll confirm that detail to you, Mr. Mountain. We'll get back to you, the committee, on that and confirm that to you, Mr. Mountain.
Thank you, Minister. My question, therefore, how did you come up with the £66, which is the most bizarre figure? It's an 8.918 percentage increase. How was the £66 figure worked out?
Once again, I'll rely on Ian's expertise in this one.
I think it's essentially an inflation calculation. I'm told that it's not the most exact calculation. It's a reasonable approximation, but I think it's essentially based on inflation.
Mr. Mountain, I believe that every election that we have, we tend to look towards inflation to see where we're at in order to make sure that we don't stay at the same amounts all the time. And it's to ensure that all the candidates are getting the value that they need for what they can actually spend.
OK, so, Minister, my question then comes down to if it's based purely on the inflation, I'm not sure how that even with doing a cumulative inflation figure for the period, that figure comes up. But anyway, this next election will be very different to previous elections because of COVID. And I still believe that a lot more will have to be done remotely. And I've argued the point before that when it comes to parliamentary elections, there's been a huge shift from hand delivery to postal delivery. Do we think that £66 increase is sufficient when it's probably been accepted already that the increase for parliamentary elections needs to be bigger than just a formulaic inflation-proof increase?
I think when you look at it as a candidate myself and a former councillor, you always say you could probably spend more money in a campaign, but I think you have to draw a line at one point in what is fair for everyone to make sure that everyone has a level playing field. And I think this gives us that opportunity, Mr. Mountain. I think when you look towards the end of the last Scottish election, when we were finally allowed to actually get involved and go out and get to some form of normal campaigning, we managed to still be able to go out, deliver the leaflets and get things forward. Personally, I don't know of many candidates locally in our area who started using mailing to that extent. I didn't personally myself, and just went forward with the campaign as is. We had a campaign light at the start. We made sure we accounted for the fact we were living in difficult times and it would be a certain way. And yes, was it a nervous time for me as a candidate? Probably was, because halfway through on the campaign, sitting in the house, I was starting to worry. But I think as we move forward, we just need to look at the give the parties the opportunity for them to continue with this limit, and I still think they should be okay. If we get data further down the line after this election that says otherwise, then as always we'll review it.
Okay, Minister, how many councillors were asked? I mean, it is some time, I suspect, since you've been a councillor, but how many councillors were asked whether they thought the spending limits were correct, and was that across every geographical area? Because, Minister, it's much easier in your area to deliver leaflets than it is in an area, say, in the north of Scotland, where there are huge geographical areas to cover. So how many councillors were asked and what were their opinions?
I take that on board. And yes, it wasn't yesterday when I was a councillor, but don't let the white hair fool you, Mr Mountain. You know, it was only at least 11, 12 years ago. Yes, I take that on board with regards to the geographic differences, and I'm aware of that. But I'll ask Ian with regards to the consultation with the local authorities and councillors.
The consultation is primarily with the, in this instance, would be primarily with the Scottish Political Parties Panel, representatives of each of the parties, and also with COSLA. So I'm not aware of individual councillors being involved. I think it was...
On the whole, COSLA, as the main body for local authorities, would have an opinion, and obviously it would be fed into from leaders and deputy leaders throughout the country, and those involved in the process, and those that are COSLA members that are leaders of groups as well. So it's been reasonably broad. It would be difficult for us to break it down into individual councillors, and because, as you know, Mr Mountain, there are quite a few of them. And it would be difficult for us to break it down into that. But as always, if there are better ways of engaging with people and there's opportunities for us to do that, we'll look at that.
So I think that's slightly disappointing that you haven't actually been the coalface, as it were, and asked councillors whether it's sufficient. I mean, I understand COSLA is a representative body, but there's a lot of councillors that don't feel that COSLA represents their particular views. I think if I was going to be doing this in your position, I would have asked a poll for councillors. So easy to do. We have SurveyMonkey and various other ways of carrying out polls of doing it. It would have been nice to know that we'd spoken to councillors. I'm disappointed by that. Minister, just pushing on slightly further, I mean, I take from what you said that you believe that there should be spending limits, and I agree with you. But I wonder if the Scottish Government are going to be thinking of spending limits in relation to COVID, in relation to the whole issue of travelling round and the effects of huge amounts of travel. I mean, I remember when I stood in Caithness, I did 14,000 miles trying to get round the constituency during the election. It was massive. And we don't want to do that. So we might need to rely more on pushing out leaflets and information. So are you going to be considering spending limits and speaking to not only councillors but MSPs to see whether they think it's the right level? And, I mean, MPs as well, whether you think that the limits are the correct level rather than just making a decision yourself?
I'm quite happy to have that dialogue with anyone with regards to how they see the way forward, Mr Mountain. With regards to what you said earlier about COSLA being a representative board and those not councils not feeling represented on it, as a former councillor, I find that difficult to believe, because even though I was a backbench councillor for much of my time as a councillor, I attended COSLA on a number of occasions and was able to input what I wanted to be said through my group. And I think that's down to individual groups and parties to be able to do that as well. And from your perspective with regards to the costs involved with campaigns, again, I would say, regarding geographic area, it's always been down to individual campaigns and parties to do that as well. Is that something, a discussion that we have for the future as to how we fund elections? Well, that's probably not for today. But it's probably something that we could discuss and debate in the future.
Okay, thank you, Minister. And my only comment in return before I hand back to the convener is a lot changes in 12 years, not only views on COSLA, but also views on election expenses. And I'm sure you'll accept that as well. Convener, thank you.
Thank you, Edward. Bob.
Thank you. I'm sure Mr Mountain and the Minister don't look very differently than they did 12 years ago. I'm sure they look old then also. But the substantive question, I suppose, Minister, is Mr Mountain does make a reasonable point in relation to consultation, as do you yourself, Minister. You mentioned that COSLA is consulted with, as are the political parties panel. Can I ask you that the next time government consults with both COSLA and the political parties panel, if we remind them they should be as extensive in their own consultation with councillors right across the country and with party activists right across the country as well, because I suspect there's a joint responsibility here, not just for government, but for political parties and for COSLA. So it's to make sure we hold to account appropriately each organisation who has that job to do consultation, not just government. So after the election, it'd be good when you have that discussion if the government reminds COSLA and political parties to do that consultation internally.
That's probably very helpful, Mr Doris, because we probably could, a lot of the technologies that Mr Mountain mentioned, COSLA and the political parties panel could probably use themselves in order to engage with their membership. And I think it's important that we remember that government is here to govern, and although we're consulting, we need to make sure that these organisations do actually consult with their own membership as well. So that's helpful, and it's maybe something we could suggest and discuss with partner organisations in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Just as a point of clarification, this SI and the increase in the spending took no account of COVID, any additional expenditure on COVID. It's just been calculated as an uplift. Is that correct? It's merely for the evidence.
I'd like to believe, but I'll soon hear from Ian if he tells me otherwise.
Yes, that's my understanding too.
Thank you. Just wanted that for purposes of clarification. If there are no further questions on that SI, we come to our last one, which is the representation of the people absent voting in local government elections, Scotland, Amendment Regulations 2021. And in essence, this SI changes the time in relation to applying for emergency proxy applications that are made after 5 p.m. And changes to that. I suppose there are a number of questions that arise from this, but I suppose the crucial one is, what was the reason for the 5 p.m. deadline for an emergency proxy for someone who is disabled, but the removal of that 5 p.m. deadline for someone who is detained?
If you wish, I'll pass on to Ian at this stage.
The principal divergence is really in relation to prisoners who've been detained for some time. So, for example, a prisoner detained on the 1st of January and the elections at the start of May, it's possible that they might, you would hope that they would put in place arrangements for post-vote or a proxy vote at that point, but it is possible that they might expect to be released on before polling day. And then something happens that means that they end up serving all of their term past polling day. And if that happens shortly in the run-up to the election, then this offers them the facility to get that emergency proxy, even though they have actually been there for some time, which seems slightly counterintuitive. But we thought that it was such a small number of people that an alternate option would be so complicated to construct that it would just confuse everyone horribly. So we put that in place. And also it raises the question of what happens when someone is detained very shortly before the normal proxy deadline. So if someone is detained, say, 6 days or 7 days before the election, they're probably not going to think, I've got 2 days to get a normal proxy. And they might only think of it a few days before polling day, in which case, if we'd applied it rigidly, they'd be too late for an emergency proxy in the classic sense. They could make an application, but we thought it was probably fair to make that a little simpler. For a disabled person, the changes here should help them as well. So if someone suffers a disability before the normal proxy deadline and understandably is unable to get
get their normal proxy through, then yes, this change will help those people and they will be able to get emergency proxy much more easily.
But only until 5 p.m.
Until 5 p.m. on the day of the election, yes.
But later for...
That, no, no, everyone's 5 p.m. on the day of the election. That's the end point for everyone getting an emergency proxy.
So the 5 p.m. deadline for a person who's detained has not been removed. That is still there.
Yes, yes, yes. It's just a slight difference for the deadline to apply for an emergency proxy, which is six days before the election.
What you do highlight, convener, quite helpfully, is the complexities of trying to legislate for the prisoner voting. And again, as I say, it's a small number of people, and it's quite difficult for us and challenging for us to actually do it. But you've perfectly highlighted that, convener.
Thank you for that. And I am conscious of time, but I was also going to raise again the question of who'd been approached with regard to seeking advice on the consultation, because again, it appears quite limited, unfortunately. And again, is something that I know the Minister has undertaken to review on a number of matters going forward, which is extremely helpful.
Just to reiterate that on this issue, rather than us go through the same process again, I'm quite happy to say we'll look at that post the next election as well. We'll take the data we have and take it from there.
That's very helpful. Does anyone on the committee have any further questions before I close this evidence section? No? Excellent. Sorry. Thank you. I'd like to thank both the Minister and those that advised the Minister for their evidence, which has been very helpful. And we're now going to move to agenda items 3 and 4, for which the Minister will stay present to formally move the motions, and we will have, if necessary, a debate on this matter. I would now like to invite the Minister to move and speak to motion S6M01320, that the Standards and Procedures and Public Appointments Committee recommends that the Representation of the People, Postal Voting for Local Government Elections, Scotland, Amendment Regulations 2021 be approved. Minister.
For brevity for yourselves and your busy agenda, moved formally, convener.
Would any committee member like to speak to this motion? Looking around. Minister, would you like to make any closing remarks?
I'm quite happy to continue.
Excellent. The question is that motion S6M01320 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed. We are all agreed. Edward's agreed. Sorry. Then we are agreed, and can confirm that the committee agrees the motion. And can I confirm that the committee is satisfied for me to sign off the report to go to the chamber? Yes. Grateful. I'd now like to invite the minister to move and speak to motion S6M01321. That the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee recommend... No. Is this the second positive one? Sorry. No, I'm right. Yeah. My apologies. That the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee recommends that the Scottish Local Government Elections Amendment Order 2021 be approved. That's a strange... Would you like to move the motion, Minister?
Moved, convener.
I'm grateful. Would any members like to speak to this motion? No? Excellent. Presume there are no closing remarks,
no
Minister?
No closing remarks.
Excellent. The question is that motion S6M01321 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yes. You're agreed. And is the committee happy for me to sign off the report to the chamber?
Yeah,
agreed. Excellent. I can now thank you, Minister, and your officials for attending as we move to the... Because we don't need to move the motion for the... No. So thank you for your attendance today.
Once again, it's been a pleasure, convener.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Agenda item 5 is the subordinate legislation, where we're being asked to consider 2 negative SSIs. Does anyone have any comments before I move to the formal element? Edward?
Convener, it's just the point on election expenses. I'm unclear that sufficient consideration has been given to election expenses in the COVID environment that we live in. And I would like to just urge, when we're talking to the Scottish Government as a committee, that we ask them to reconsider this and consult more widely on whether they're appropriate, including when it comes to local government officials, independent councillors, who may well have been not included in previous consideration by COSLA and such organisations.
I think it's fair to say, Edward, that the evidence that we heard is right, that this SSI did not include any COVID influenced extensions, and I think it would be right for the committee to write to point that out, because we don't know what the situation will be next year. We all hope we know what the situation will be, but we, you know, I think experience tells us to be careful about making assumptions. And I think, to be fair to the answer that that Bob got, that there is an understanding that a better and wider consultation, specifically in relation to this negative SSI with regard to individual councillors through COSLA and their bodies, needs to be made. And I think it is fair that the evidence that we've heard, and I'm assured by that, that there will be a wider consultation in relation to particularly groups that are influenced by these SSIs. Does that make
sense? I'm happy with that. I just want to put it on record.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. So as a committee, do we agree that we wish to make no recommendations in relation to those except that which appears on the evidence?
Agreed.
Agreed. I'm grateful. We now move to agenda item 6. Our next item is for the committee to consider an update to the guidance on bills. A number of standing order rule changes were agreed by the Parliament during session 5. And as a consequence of these changes, the necessary revisions to the guidance on public bills have been made. Do any members have any comments on the guidance which has been provided to us? No? Excellent. Are members content to agree and approve for publication the revised guidance? Agreed. We now move to agenda item 7, the cross-party groups. Agenda item 7 is for the committee to consider the application for recognition from 5 cross-party groups. The first group we will consider today is the proposed CPG on Ireland. And I hopefully would like to welcome James Dornan, who is the convener of the proposed group and is joining us remotely.
Hi.
Ah, good morning, James. You have made it through to us. Can I thank you for your attendance? And we are being asked to consider and approve the application for recognition at agenda item 8, and in due course the clerks will inform you of the committee's decision. But would you like to make any opening comments with regard to the proposed CBG? Over to you, James.
Thank you very much, convener. Just basically to say that the Ireland is one of our closest neighbours. This cross-party group would be about creating links for both culture and business, but fostering further links between culture and business, but also to give the Irish voice in Scotland a place to be heard. The Irish community is one of the biggest migrant communities in Scotland, and I think it's important that the Scottish Parliament has a distinct place for the Irish community to be able to come and tell their stories, tell the successes that they have living in Scotland, and also for us to be able to strengthen the link between the two islands.
Thank you very much, James. I now hope you're open to questions if the committee have any questions.
Yeah.
And I'm just looking around, and I don't know if Edward did. No, that's fine. Just for the record, James, you've been appointed as the convener. Can you tell us who your vice or deputy convener is, please?
Yes, of course. I have Finlay Carson as the vice convener. We have, to date, we've got 7 MSPs from 4 parties who have said they will join. We have countless organisations and individuals who have also are keen to join if this gets up and running.
Excellent. Thank you very much, James. Are there any other questions? No. As I said at the start, James, the clerks will be in touch when we make our decision on this on the next agenda item. But can I thank you for joining us today? And we will no doubt speak soon. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
The next group that we will consider is a proposed CPG on long COVID. And I would like to welcome and invite Jackie Bailey, MSP, who is the co-convener of the proposed group, to this meeting. Again, the next agenda item will be when we decide on the CPG, and the clerks will notify you that in due course. But can I invite you to make an opening statement about your proposed CPG?
Thank you very much, convener, and can I thank you and the members of the committee for your time this morning. The pandemic, I think, touched everybody in Scotland, but unfortunately the impact of the pandemic on some still lingers and has quite serious consequences. We were asked, a number of us as MSPs, by Long COVID Scotland, representing ordinary people across Scotland still suffering from the after effects of COVID, to actually set up a cross-party group. They asked us to do so to bring, you know, a real focus to the issue, to highlight and recognise the problems that they're experiencing, but also to ensure that service provision is there and it's appropriate, to try and influence the policy emerging from the Scottish Government, and to really bring to the Parliament the experiences and the lived experience of people suffering from long COVID. So I've had discussions with colleagues, we set up the cross-party group, and we are here today hoping that you will support us.
I'm very grateful for that. Does anyone have any questions? Bob?
Just very briefly, welcome to the committee, Jackie Bailey. I'm pleased you could come along here this morning. I think in your opening statement, you probably commented on the question I wanted to ask, which was in relation to the purpose of the cross-party group and who can disagree with the purpose, but I didn't see anything in the purpose about how those with lived experience of long COVID can help shape improved and enhanced services and service provision in a positive and a constructive way. I know Long COVID Scotland want to do that, and I didn't quite see it reflected in the purpose of the group, but I think what you've put on the record this morning gives me, not the reassurance, because it's up to the cross-party group to shape its own work programme, but it gives me a confidence that will be a key part of the objectives of the cross-party group. So I just want to put that on the record. I don't know if you want to add anything to that, Jackie.
Absolutely, and can I agree with what you're saying? I suppose because it's such a core part of the group, it isn't a single objective. The group is indeed serviced by Long COVID Scotland, which brings those voices right into the Parliament. The cross-party group and myself are trying to, even as we speak, negotiate with the Cabinet Secretary for Health to ensure that that lived experience feeds through into government policy as well. So we see this very much as a supporting vehicle to help to do that. But they are central to the cross-party group, central to every agenda that we will have, and we will certainly promote that work. So I'm happy to reassure Bob Doris that that's the case.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. I'd like to pass over to Edward.
Thank you, convener. And actually, Jackie answered my question in her answer to the last question. It was about how to reach out and include everyone who is suffering from long COVID. And it was just really a question of how you're going to do that and how you're going to make the people who are suffering aware of all you're trying to do, because I think it's a very laudable aim and you'll be breaking new ground. But you partly answered the question, but if you could give me a bit more information, I'd appreciate it. Jackie.
Sure. Long COVID Scotland represents, you know, hundreds upon hundreds of long COVID sufferers in Scotland. We don't just have them as members. There's Long COVID Kids. There's a variety of different organisations who are, you know, very active in this space that will bring that knowledge directly to the Parliament and to the cross-party group, but are also willing to share that with government. And I think they provide, if you've listened to any of them describe their experiences, it is hugely powerful and I think is very welcome for policymakers, you know, across Scotland, about how we ensure that people with long COVID, with their myriad complex systems, are actually catered for within our public services and how they're assisted in their journey to recovery.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Edward. And thank you, Jackie. And just my question, you come to us as co-convener, and it's right to say that Alex Cole-Hamilton, MSP, and Sandish Gulhani, MSP, are the other co Is that correct?
That's right. We like to be very inclusive and cross-party, and therefore, you know, we share the responsibility because it actually, I think, reflects well on the Parliament that we can operate in that way.
That's excellent. Thank you very much for your evidence today, Jackie. And as I say, we will be in touch with the next matter. I'm just going to call a short suspension while we change over witnesses.
Thank you, Convener.
Excellent. Welcome back. And the committee is continuing to consider CPGs. And I would like to welcome Liz Smith, MSP, to consider a proposed CPG on outdoor education. We will actually make the decision on the next agenda item. The clerks will be in touch with you. But would you like to make any opening comments about the proposed CPG?
Yes, I would. Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you to the committee for giving up their time to listen to what I've got to say. I mean, I think most people around the table are very aware that of the 15 years that I've been in this Parliament, outdoor education has been a very strong personal interest. But as time has gone on, I'm very struck by just how much it means to so many members across the whole political spectrum. And you will know from recent debates that we've had, members' debates and discussions that we've had around the whole subject, it's something that I think is capturing the imagination. And obviously with the COVID situation, I think outdoor education and all the assets that it brings are absolutely vital to young people's well-being. And it's very clear from what members have said in debates that we feel that, you know, with the pressures on education just now, and most especially on the pressures that we have for outdoor education centres, there is a real issue here. And I think I've chaired the cross-party group on sport for quite some time, and while there is a distinction between sport and outdoor education, I think one of the things that I felt convening it is that one of the gaps in the Parliament is that we don't have a sufficiently discrete group on outdoor education. And I spoke to various colleagues across the political spectrum while thinking about setting this up, and they were very keen about doing that. So that's where we are. I did a sort of informal consultation about it. I spoke to a lot of people with whom I have very considerable contacts in the outdoor education centre world, and we agreed that it would be something not just to help the Parliament engage with the sector, which I think, as I say, is increasingly important, but also to help local authorities and schools and people who have got, you know, really strong interests in perhaps the unmeasurable aspect of education, which I would defend as being the most important. It's something that, as I say, I think we all feel quite passionate about. So that's where we are. That's basic reasons for it, convener. And I set out in my paper about you know, what the purpose was.
Excellent. Thank you. Does anyone on the committee have any questions? No? I'd just like to say that you have a very, very broad set of organisations from Outwith that are supporting that, and that is very good to see. Yeah. And just for the evidence, the deputy convener is Daniel Johnson. Okay. Is that right? Excellent. Thank you. Wish you all well, should we give credence in our next agenda item, but can I thank you for your attendance today?
Thank you very much, convener. I appreciate that.
And we have a short suspension. Thank you. Ready when? Excellent, and welcome back. And the committee would like to welcome Rona Mackay, MSP, who is joining us with a proposal for a CPG on women, families and justice. And I would first like to say welcome and invite Rona to make any opening comments that she would like about the proposed CPG.
Okay, thank you, convener. I was convener of Women and Justice cross-party group, which started in 2018. And it became increasingly clear that what we were discussing involved children and families, and that there was a cross-party group called Families Affected by Imprisonment. And they regularly attended our cross-party group and contributed. And it seemed logical and sensible that the two groups should merge because, you know, we were sharing the agenda on many occasions and basically speaking about the same thing, that women going through the justice system, the problems that they face, and that affects their families and their wider families. So it just seemed a sensible solution just to merge for this session.
Thank you very much. Do any committee members have any questions that they'd like to pass around? Bob.
Thanks, convener. Morning, Rona. Just very, very briefly, I suppose a constituency interest, I'm just taking my opportunity by pusher here to ask this question. I know alternatives to custody for women will be part of the work of the group, given we're failing too many women by locking them up, quite frankly. My constituency is one of the new smaller custodial units for women being developed in Maryhill, and I think we're all very keen to see what a difference these establishments can make to better make sure that women who, if it's unavoidable that they have to be held in a custodial unit, that they still have access to their families and wider support mechanisms, they're not cut off from that wider family group. And I'm just wondering if, as these new establishments come online, as they all do through the course of this Parliament, if that will be part of the work of the cross-party group to see how effective or otherwise these establishments have been.
Yeah, sure. It has been part of our work, knowing that they're nearing completion now. And we are very keen to press that contact is made between, you know, mothers and children. We're asking for mother and baby units to be part of these units, so that mothers can bond with their babies and they're not separated. So it has been part of our work and very much part of our ongoing work. And, you know, we have taken evidence and, you know, from the prison service on many occasions about it. So definitely ongoing and definitely very necessary. Yeah.
I want to give you the opportunity to put some of that on the record. Thanks.
Thank you.
Tess, if I can hand over to you.
Thank you. I think it's an important CPG. I've just got two questions, sure, if I may. What are your personal, as convener, measures of success for this CPG?
I think highlighting the huge issues faced by women who are on remand, far too many women in remand and far too many women still in custody. You know, 10 years on from the Angelini report, which said we have to stop locking up women for low-level offences, it's still happening. So, you know, and there's so many causes of that. It can be, you know, addiction problems, mental health problems, chaotic lifestyles, and prison is not the place for women at that level. I think our objective is to keep pressing for that, looking at, you know, pretty radical new ways, actually, of keeping women out of prison, because it doesn't just affect them, it doesn't help them. It makes the situation that they find themselves in much worse for their mental health, etc. But it also affects, you know, the wider family and their children. Only 5% of children whose mother is imprisoned remain in the family home. You know, so that gives you an indication of how disruptive it is. So I think what we're doing is focusing just on all aspects of how that could be improved and a much more holistic method could come in.
Keeping women out of prison.
Yes.
And then focus on that. So you won't be focusing on the safety
of women in prison at all?
Well, yeah, I mean, just it's all aspects of women in the justice system. And, you know, far too many women in prison have mental health problems. Far too many women have been victims of domestic abuse and are brain injured. So, you know, there's huge issues that we need to look at. And I hope that, you know, last session we made a start with the Women in Justice Group. And I'm hoping that this session we can really, really dig deep into those issues and try and effect a lot of change.
Thank you. I'd like to fully support this CPG.
We'll get to that point at the next agenda, but your intention is noted. Just for the record, can you tell us who the co- or vice convener is for?
Colette Stevenson.
Excellent, thank you. And I must say, from the application that you've put in, it's wonderful to see so many organisations supporting this.
Yeah.
And also, just to also put on the record, the very positive nature of managing to bring together two CPGs where there is so much overlap.
Yeah.
And that going forward, hopefully, be a stronger voice. So, Rona, can I thank you very much for coming towards the committee
thank
this
you.
Morning. We'll make the decision on the next agenda item, and the clerks will let you know.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
And I'll call a short suspension. And I welcome people back to the final group that we are going to consider today, which is a proposed CPG on culture and communities. And I'd like to welcome Sarah Boyack, MSP, who joins us as the convener of the proposed group. Sarah, would you like to make some opening comments?
Yes, thanks very much, convener. Really want to set up this group after quite a lot of reflection from the members of the group and also learning from experiences, in particularly in the last parliamentary term. The term culture covers a huge number of areas, and there's a very strong suggestion that it's actually too broad for a cross-party group. For example, if you take the Scottish Government, they have got separate culture and creative industries departments with a full department for each, and they've got different aims, objectives and strategies. So we thought in terms of exploring accountability issues, that would make a lot of sense. But there was also a real grassroots sense that if you look at the two areas, communities and industrial sector, publicly funded sector, libraries, museums, national performing companies, and we've got lots and lots of community arts groups and culture groups that want to have a voice and want to speak to us in the context of a CPG, not through our committee. And then you've got the industrial sector, publishing companies, record companies, entrepreneurs, the whole media sector. So it's actually a huge area to cover. So we've spoken to Culture Count to represent the sector, and we were thinking that if we have two cross-party groups, it actually lets both MSPs and the sector be able to have a proper focus on both areas. The other thing we wanted to reassure you is we are not planning necessarily on having eight CPG meetings a year as opposed to four. We were actually thinking of maybe doing experimenting the first year and having two meetings for each of the CPGs, with the opportunity of having more depending on the members of our groups. So I think it's going to work really well. There's a lot of enthusiasm for it, and I hope you're going to be okay with it, because we think it's a good idea. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Does anyone have any questions? Looking around. Tess.
So thank you for that. So did you say you're only going to have two meetings a year?
For each cross-party group. There's going to be the cross-party group on the culture that will relate to communities, and then one that will be much more related to the industry in terms of culture. And we wanted to mirror the two Scottish Government departments, so we've got one for each. And it's partly as we come out of COVID, to be honest, we're thinking of giving ourselves the aim of doing two each. So we've had one first meeting of everybody. So we reckon that in the next few months, we'll do another two meetings for our cross-party group in this first year. We might do more in the future.
OK, and just one more question, convener, if I may. Your measures of success, how will you know that the CPG is working as you would want it to work?
One, I think for the community's perspective, we now have so many grassroots organisations that are involved in culture across the country that we want it to be really inclusive. So the engagement opportunities and also being able to follow up what the Scottish Government strategy is and see how that's working in practice. It's something the committee is looking at, but this would be enabling us to do a much more grassroots approach and involve people on the ground. And I think that's something that's been missing, because the existing culture cross-party group is just trying to cover far too much. So people in the sector being happy and feeling included and having access to MSPs, I think, would be our number one objective this year as our first aim as the culture and communities group.
Final question. So engagement is the way you'll be measuring it. Do you have any engagement indicator, or is it a general view that you'll take at the end of the year?
I will definitely review it at the end of the year. And I think this is it's kind of a grassroots sense that people have felt excluded from the CPG and culture in the past, because it has tended to be dominated more by the creative industry sector, which is also really important. So it's to make sure that both sides do get a voice and do get an input.
Thanks, Bob.
Thanks for coming along. Sarah, I know it's a busy morning for you. I hadn't intended asking a question, but I just thought we'd go and look at the list of cross-party groups that have been approved. And you'd mentioned the music sector in some of your comments. There's a cross-party group in music. There's clearly room for both cross-party groups to exist. But I'm just wondering what the relationship may be with the cross-party group music that might be looking at maybe a variety of things that the cross-party group that you're seeking approval for may also seek to look at. So just would you look at any partnership working or common themes or just any thoughts on that?
Not at this point, no. The first cross-party group we had was a very high-level discussion and it had quite a big attendance, I think. So I think Culture Count's comment was we could have about 20 different culture groups, and we're thinking about the whole range of issues: crafts, fashions and textile, designs, photography, writing and publishing, heritage, cultural education, performing arts. I mean, it's still quite a huge section, even without thinking about the CPG on music. So I don't think we're worried that we're going to overlap on each other.
I anticipated that would be the answer, but in the nature of these exchanges, you just want to just ask certain questions because overlap's a theme that comes up quite often, not specific to this cross-party group, but just as a more general matter that this committee looks at. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. I suppose just for the record, who will the deputy convener be?
Is that in our form? I think we have formally applied as a group, haven't we?
Is it Sue Webber? Yes, Sue. That's all right. And I mean, just partly to follow on from Bob, and this is absolutely not a criticism, and in fact, I'm welcome the way that the proposed CPG has dealt with this, because there are a number of concerns expressed about the total number of CPGs that exist, but I'm very welcome your comments, Sarah, about the need for two separate CPGs, but that the workload that the two will do will reduce and are approached to different people so that MSPs can witness the experience and indeed the knowledge that different sectors bring. I think that's most helpful. So can I thank you for your attendance today? We'll make the decision on the next agenda item and the clerks will be in touch, but thank you for your time.
Thanks. I think the only thing I didn't clarify was that we would be looking at the publicly funded remit and the creative industry sector would look at the private sector. Yes. So that's and go back to that, the different government departments. That was a key issue for us as well.
It's very helpful.
I appreciate I've not been to one of these, so I appreciate looking at previous discussions about the committee. I hope that's answered your questions.
No, that's kind. Thank you very much indeed, Sarah. We now move to agenda item 8, which is the cross-party group approval. It is for the committee to consider whether to accord recognition to the proposed cross-party groups that we've heard from today. That is on Ireland, on long COVID, outdoor education, women and families and justice, and culture and communities. Are there any comments from any of the committee members before I formally move to asking? Tess had a comment.
My only point around the island, so is we have BEPA, the British Irish Parliamentary Assembly, and just to follow up, I support setting it up, but just to follow up to make sure there is reference in that CPG to BEPA and the work that BEPA does.
Yes, the British and Irish Parliamentary Group are a group that's been in existence for a long term and allow coordination between the parliamentarians from the different areas. And I know from experience how valuable it is. And although it wasn't confirmed in the evidence, I'm quite sure that they will be involved. But what I will do is undertake to speak to the convener if we agree the group, just to point out your comments on that.
Thank you.
Are there any other comments about any of the groups? Or can I formally ask if the committee are in agreement to the formation of the groups that we've heard from this morning? I think we are all in agreement. Agenda item 9 is the cross-party groups re-registration. Our final item today is for the committee to consider a change of purpose for the proposed CPG on colleges and universities and the proposed CPG on nuclear disarmament, and a change of name and purpose for the proposed CPG on improving Scotland's health. As members are aware, these changes of name or purpose have to come before the committee to be formally approved. Do anybody have any comments that they would like to make? Or I was intending just to put this as a single question to the committee. If we're happy with the single question, are we agreed that the proposed CPGs on colleges and universities, nuclear disarmament and improving Scotland's health can be re-registered in the new session? Agreed?
Agreed.
We're in agreement with that. And can I thank the committee members for today? And that concludes our meeting today. Thank you, Edward, Tess, Paul, and thank you, Bob.